So I think next talk is from Dr. Kamal Kapoor from Sharpsight Centers, and he's a dynamic surgeon. He's speaking on, he does a lot of refractive cataract surgery, and he's very well renowned all over the country for his amazing music and his science. So he will be speaking on accurate biometry.
I must thank the chair, Dr. Lane, Dr. Ragini, my dear friend Gaurav, and Dr. Vinod. I'll be talking about the accurate biometry. I guess I'm sorry to be a bit late. I got caught in traffic. I had some meetings which I had to attend. I'll be actually getting the interest back to biometry, because a lot of times we are focusing so much on the surgical part of it. The biometry at times becomes a little bit cornerstone. The patient is not bothered how meticulous and a skilled surgeon you are, what skill it takes to give you a central circular rexus, what skill it takes to actually operate in 2.8 or 3 millimeter space. The only thing he's bothered about is how is he seeing after the surgery. And that result exactly connotes or equates to the skill of the surgeon. You could have done the best surgery possible, but if the vision is not what the patient expected, you're a bad surgeon. So when a patient comes to us for cataract surgery, how many of us think that he's come to us for a cataract surgery? Good. He's come to us for clear vision. He's not come for a cataract surgery. We are the ones who are telling him that to give you clear vision, we need to do a cataract surgery. So we need to walk the talk. So wisdom, you cannot please them all. It's impossible. So be mentally prepared. And while you are mentally prepared, keep working on your systems and processes to land bang on target. Never use a word guaranteed no glasses. This is a strict dictum which we follow in our own practice. So what are the reasons for error which happen in a practice? People in a hurry, doctor in a hurry, optometrist in a hurry, wrong readings, wrong scanning, wrong axis. Wrong formula is one of the most frequent things. I was studying the literature. Wrong formula and wrong A constant contributes to nearly 67% of biometric errors. And it is something so common. So if you could just polish our systems, what are the issues we actually encounter when we're doing a biometry? Abnormal eyes, selection of right formulas, biometry in post-corneal refractive surgery is done, biometry post-phakic lenses, biometry in phakic IOLs, silicone IOL, pediatric cases, post-vitrectomized eyes, and other corneal procedures. So we'll see one by one. Few things, salient points, I'll jump. I skipped a few slides as Dr. Rajendra Prasad was speaking. I took off a lot of slides because I realized there was some commonality. Alignment of the probe when you're doing an immersion, oblique, and applanation biometry. The configuration of spikes has to be understood by the doctor, oblique, the optometrist, whether the spikes are right or not. Axial errors in smaller eyes have more damage to your result than a longer eye. A longer eye would be more forgiving than a shorter eye. And always watch out for abnormal readings. Abnormal readings of keratometry between both eyes. So we have some patterns which are called red flags in all the optometrist rooms. So this is something like this, that the optometrist is supposed to see this every day morning when he comes. Before he starts doing his biometry, these things are stuck in the biometry room also. If there is a difference between average of more than 1.25 keratometric difference, more axis difference, axial length difference, standard deviation in consecutive readings, these are to be noted. If the eye is smaller than 22 diopters, repeat the reading. Call somebody else to do the reading in case you're using an immersion. Eyes higher than normal expected. Difference between both the eyes. So all these things are to be done. History of a refractive surgery. Shift the patient to an optical biometry. So if you follow these rules and these formulas, and our optometrists and technicians do this, it becomes a lot easier. I will not get into the different formulas, but we are using a lot of fourth generation formulas now. I, for one, have become a big fan of Dr. Barrett's formula. So few things, where do these formulas go wrong? If there is a surface disorder, all formulas will go wrong. If you have a patient who's got a dry eye, your keratometry will go off and you will have a bad result. So no formula is going to work. In case your keratometry is flatter than 40, but your axial length falls within the sweet spot of 23 millimeter, SRKT is a bad formula to use. So these are things which we are not actually taught. So even the cornea, steepness and flatness will affect your choice of formulas. If you have a sweet spot between say 22 to 24 or 25, you would normally, your favorite formula would be probably, I guess, SRKT, but not in these situations. If your keratometry is very steep, do not go to SRKT. There are other formulas which are recommended for that. So Hages and Holiday 2 are recommended formulas when you have a freak, little bit more peaked keratometries. Now, how would you actually shift from applanation to immersion? When you shift from applanation to immersion, immersion is definitely far more gold standard when it comes to an ultrasonic biometry. Applanation, I don't think most of us are doing now. But for the ones who are shifting, a good idea to actually shift around 0.2 to 0.28 from your A constant, which you were using with the applanation tonometry. Now, once you want to shift from immersion to optical, which is a natural progression, the best thing would be to, in case you're a beginner, go to the ULIB site. This is how the site looks. You look up the IL formula or the IL choice which you're seeing and see the optical A constant for that. And then with the first few 20 cases, you'll fine tune your own optical A constant. Otherwise, what makes a good sense is actually do 20 eyes with this and see whether it lands bang on target or not. So what we do is, now the next thing, next generation is the swept source OCT. We've shifted to the swept source OCT. A big advantage over the simple optical biometer was that in case of central axial cataracts, posterior subcapsular cataracts, thick cataracts, the machine would not give a reading. But with these new machines, nearly 70 to 80% of such cases, you're again able to take the readings with a swept source biometer. Now, this is what I do in my practice. I shift all my constants from applanation to when I need to shift from lens constant of an optical biometer. So if you add to all these A constants, you will get the final A constant which should work for your machine. At times, both may be required. You might want to do an immersion and optical both, because the optical may not be giving you a right reading, or you may have doubts or variable readings. Now, there are various formulas explained. I skipped a few slides. I'll again touch it back again. So less than 20, in my practice, we use Holiday 2. 20 to 22, we use Hages. I personally use Hages. A lot of other my friends, they probably prefer HOFOQ. SRKT, actually in standard practice with normal, little bit of variation, is a wonderful formula to use. But the newer formulas of Barrett 2 and Dr. Hill's formula are very accurate. So in my practice, we are slowly shifting to the Barrett Universal 2, especially in post-RK and post-LASIK cases. Now, this is again the similar diagram. This gives you, those two lines give you the sweet spot of that particular formula for that particular axial length. And add on top of it the keratometry. Please do not forget the keratometry. If the keratometry is steeper or very flat, then you need to go back to the third generation formulas. So smaller keratometries, again, this is just describing the whole thing. Now, Barrett Universal 2 formula, personal choice for post-LASIK or post-RK patients. It gives you very, very fair, accurate readings. The reasons for error mostly in these cases are that, as I said, very flat or very steep keratometry, we've used a wrong formula. Hages formula will be most affected if the lens thickness is a little bit abnormal. You have a very thick lens, you have a intumescent cataract, you might have a wrong reading with the Hages formula. So these are the sensitive spots of these formulas. The SRKT is sensitive to the cornea. There are some formulas which are very sensitive to the anterior chamber depth. So if the anterior chamber depth, a little bit haywire, you have a little bit of subluxated cataract, better not to use that formula. So if you have a very thick cataract, these are the formulas which will actually start going haywire. Now coming to post-RK. Post-RK, we are getting a lot of patients who are post-RK in our practice, because RK at the time when it was done, most of these patients have reached the age of cataract. Now, very important thing when you're doing a post-refractive surgery patient is take the history. So many times we've had ladies coming to the clinic and my optometrist saying, sir, keratometry is too flat. I think she's got a surgery done, and the lady will keep denying it. So only to be questioned alone, she says, okay, my husband was there with me. I have not told him that I got a PRK done so many years ago. Sometimes you may miss the LASIK marks of the flap. So if you see a flatter keratometry, please take history, and personal advice, take it separately, especially if it's a lady patient, because some of times they may not share this information and you may have an error while doing this situation. So history taking, very important. Two or three things we need to understand. When we do a LASIK, we only flatten the anterior surface, superior surface. The internal depth is not changed. The internal flattening doesn't happen. So this is where the formulas will start going wrong more. Whereas when you do an RK, you generally flatten the whole cornea, maybe more in the center and a little bit steeper in the periphery, but the whole cornea has a flattening effect. So this has a different effect on the ELP or the effective lens position. So there are different formulas. I will not get into this. You can use, I'll give you some links which you can actually take photograph or download those links. ASCRS website is a beautiful free to use website, or Barrett formulas which are available. So one thing we need to understand is most of these patients may have irregular astigmatism. Now if that irregular astigmatism is gross, I in my practice avoid using toric lenses, because the error of such a high astigmatism on getting the right power, right alignment, and you might probably add more to the problems of the patient. Number two, these patients are to be prescribed glasses at least 2 to 3 months after the surgery. Unlike your standard practice of 2 to 3 weeks post cataract surgery, in post RK patients, the cornea will keep having changes, and you have to warn these patients that they will have a hyperopic shift all their life. It's called a perennial instability degeneration. It will keep happening. So as I said, I, in my practice, do not use multifocals, at least in my post-RK patients. It's a strict no, we don't do that, though these patients are very driven to go for multifocals because that's the reason they got the RK done in the first place, but we don't do that. Now, depending on the number of the cuts the cornea has, you can have the predictability of your stability of the IOL power. More the number of cuts, less stable the refractive power is going to be. So on the first consult itself, we tell the patient, we are going to target as near to an emetropia, but there is a very, very heavy chance that you will land in my emetropia, but not stay there. Maybe in a few months, maybe in a year, be mentally prepared. So once you have a communication link established with the patients are not going to be unhappy. So in case you're planning for a toric, wound stability is very important. Sometimes these corneal incisions may open, you might want to suture them. So predictability of a toric lens is these cases when you actually see a very deep cut which is not fibrosed, and you can actually see a dark line in between in the center, which means this may open up on fluctuations of the anterior chamber pressure, especially if you're using a high bottle height. So using a topography for such patients to find an average keratometry, going for the lowest possible keratometry. Now diurnal variation, I'll be very fast now. Diurnal variation is seen in post-RK patients. These patients will have a different keratometry in the morning and a different keratometry in the evening. There is going to be a hyperopic or a myopic shift. You have to find an average keratometry of both these times and hit the target. Perennial instability we've already talked about. Now post-LASIK issues are nailing the same, but these pressures are more driven to ask you for being spectacle-free. As I said, PRK may be missed. In post-LASIK, the ELP will go wrong because the keratometry is flattened, but the internal anterior chamber depth is not altered, unlike the RK. So your chances of going wrong are higher in LASIK than in RK. There are different formulas which are available, the Haggis and the Holiday. I'll give you the links for that. Post-vitrectomy, again, you will get bad readings. Now, two things we should decide. Is the silicone oil going to be there forever? Because sometimes we just don't want to remove the silicone oil. Then you have to use the biometry which you are getting. But in case you are planning to remove the silicone oil, then you have to use a formula which we'll discuss. Another thing is, it's a good idea before you start your vitreoretina surgery, if possible, do the axial length and keep it with you. Because in case you're using a silicone oil, you will land up with a cataract, and at that point you'll be fumbling. So better to have the axial length of these patients when you can. I've started doing this in my practice and it really helps us in these situations. You could actually have different formulas for different viscosities of the silicone oil. I'll just give you a basic formula. I was just reading online, 0.7 multiplied by the measured axial length will give you the real axial length in case you're using a silicone oil of 1,000 to 1,300 centistocks. This will give you the real axial length, and then you can put this axial length into your SRKT. So you can note it down if it works for you. Pediatric IOL calculation, there is so much of confusion still. There is still not standardized formulas available. There are practical issues of measuring axial lengths, keratometries in these children, the issues of getting a general anesthesia for these children. Some of these children may have, you know, antecedent systemic issues, putting them under general anesthesia for just EUA, but I think it actually worth it. The biometry, doing a good job of biometry in a pediatric case is half the job done. It's actually the follow-up, taking care of the amblyopia. So these are various still protocols recommended. Sometimes they work, sometimes they don't work. I probably would like to hear more from Dr. Gaurav on this, because I still have not been able to get the sweet spot on the pediatric cataract area. Post-keratoplasty, there are myoptic sites. I'll just go faster, and now I'll just show you some links. Okay, now, this is a link which works for the ASCRS site. This is how it works. You can actually go open this site, go on IOL power calculations, and you will get whatever data you need to go, and you will get the data from there. Now, the next link would be, this is a calculator which is available free to download online. It really works for me. If I'm sitting in my chamber and the A constant needs to be shifted, the IOL needs to be shifted, this is a fantastic this thing. You can actually convert the A constant. You will, if you put in the SRKT, you will get the Hages, you will get all the A constant. This is free to download. It's called a Payman IOL calculator. It's on all the systems in my organization, even in the operation theater. Suppose the patient is changing lenses and the IOL has been calculated on a different formula, you want to actually go back to an accurate A constant. So this is available online. You can actually calculate your SIA. We have this Excel sheet calculator, which is again available online. You can actually put in your data of preoperative keratometry, postoperative keratometry, 10 to 20 cases, it will calculate a SIA. This is again available online. Piggyback, a lot of times after you've done a surgery, so I have got this Excel sheet where you actually can calculate the piggyback. You just put in the refractive error and the keratometry. This will give you the exact piggyback lens which you put, and this works like magic. So I guess, thank you.
Thank you, Kamal Kapoor. Now I will invite